Today, information and communication technologies are a very important aspect of higher education. We'll call them ICT as a short form, and we will see how ICTs are useful for higher education in all aspects of higher education, teaching, learning, evaluation, research, and many other things. In 1996, a commission was appointed by UNESCO to give them an idea of future education. Their report is titled as Learning the Treasure Within. They are suggesting the four pillars of education. They are learning to know, learning to live together, learning to do, and learning to be. Keeping these four pillars in mind, now we will see how the learning takes place. See here, learning is the only first person activity. People can help us, but ultimately the responsibility of learning is that of learner. UNESCO has brought out a regional guide that is for ICT transforming education. It is worth reading. They are telling us that there are three types of skills for new generation, that is 21st century learners. One is life and career skill, other is learning and innovation skills, and the third set is information, media and technology skills. It is that important skill set which the 21st century learner must have. OECD countries have an organization called PISA, that is Program for International Student Assessment. They assess the students in various countries and bring out a report in which they are saying that what is important today are three different areas under which the assessment is done. One is to act autonomously, that is proactively, not a reaction, but it is proactive action or autonomous action on the part of the learner is very important. Secondly, interact in heterogeneous groups. Henceforth, today's world is expecting any person to work in groups, and that group need not necessarily be homogeneous. You will have members who have different backgrounds and the group becomes heterogeneous. How do we work in such heterogeneous groups? Do we have that skill set? PISA assesses the students on the basis of this aspect. And the third important aspect is use tools interactively. These tools are language tools, ICT tools, so that interaction, it's not only one-way presentation. We are talking about interacting with people by using these tools. That important is ICT in the whole field of education, not only in higher education, but also in school education. Today, we are talking about e-learning. The information and communication technologies have helped us to go ahead with blended learning as well as e-learning. The word e-learning is coined by John Sadowski. What is e-learning? It is E stands for exciting, energetic, enthusiastic, extended, excellent, emotional learning. And I have added educational to it. E-learning is all about education. How do we learn with all these aspects? The learner must be excited about it. Learner must enjoy the whole process of learning. But he or she also must be accountable for his or her own learning. If we think about the process of learning and teaching in schools or in colleges or universities, there are four major aspects to it. One is communication. Other is content. You must have a content to communicate. Then we assess it, whether it is learned or not. These four aspects are content, communication, assessment, and class management. How do we do this with help of ICTs? Let us see. The content can be designed, developed, created using wikis, using podcasting, and it also can be communicated. How do we communicate with learners? It can be communicated with many tools. One example is given here is blog. The content communication also can be managed through learning management system, LMS. There are many LMSs available, which is, we can also call it content management system. So it can be learning and content management system, where both are managed, both are used for communication with the students. The assessment can be done using recent trends like ePortfolio, rubrics, clickers, and there are many other tools, physical tools as well as soft tools available to teachers if he or she decides to use information and communication technology. This also tells you about various other aspects of teaching learning process and their reflection. When we are talking about, say, ePortfolio, it is not only collection of what you have done. Basically, it is a reflection how a learner learns, what is the process of learning for that individual. Those reflections they form a very important part of ePortfolio. When we are talking about communication through blogs and other ICT tools, that also allows you to build learning communities. So learning communities becomes a part of your communication of your content. While communicating, if you are involving people, you are creating a community, which means you want to collaborate. In a classroom, face-to-face classroom, this gets restricted. But if you are using ICT, information and communication technology tools, then cooperation and collaboration is definitely possible across the world. Before going into the details of various ICT tools, how we can use them in our classrooms or outside the classrooms for teaching and learning process, let us take a look at what are different trends in technology today. There is an expert called Curtis Bonk. He is a teacher, professor, but also a good writer, good communicator, and a technologist. He is taking stock of 16 current trends in technology. Let us list them here. One is inexpensive laptops and netbooks, online language learning, tablet computers, or we call it iPad for Apple, pocket dictionaries and digital textbooks, video conferencing and webcamming. Mobile learning is an important trend today. Shared online video, social networking or gaming, e-book readers, massive open online courses, that is MOOC, and OCW, online courseware. Badges for online learning. These are not certificates. These are badges for attending any MOOC, because in the MOOC, there are lakhs of students learning at a particular time. So it is not possible for the organizers or the teachers to assess them. So the badges are given. So this is also a new trend. The learner doesn't want a certification, but he or she is interested in badges. Open source software. Open source tools for learning management system or content management system. One example of open source is Moodle. People are interested in learning languages, and we have seen online learning languages is one important aspect, one important trend. But language translation tools are also another important trend. Online portals and open education resource is a very important trend today. We will see how open education resources have entered higher education in a big way and how it is bringing the cost of higher education down. Online learning and augmented reality are other trends. We should know that information and communication technology tools can be effectively used for a variety of purposes which are related to higher education. One of that is finding and using content. As a teacher or as a learner, you would need to see what is the relevant content. And many tools are available. They can be used for finding this content and also using it at an appropriate place. The second use can be creating and sharing content. Today, we will also see that user-generated content is a very important aspect of higher education. So creating a content, preparing a PowerPoint presentation, having a photograph, creating a small video, creating audio file. There are so many things which the learner or the teacher can create themselves. We don't have to depend on somebody else. We also can term this as co-creation. So if two or three or a group of members are creating some content together, that can be also called as co-creation. So creating content and also sharing that content. I prepare a video, a small video of 1 minute. I want to share that. So there are ICT tools available to you to share it. And we all know that generally we use YouTube, a TeacherTube. There are many other tools available for sharing. The third use could be joining and building networks and communities. These communities are also called as learning communities. So we come together, we share our interests, but we also share our resources which we have created. Exchange of resources generates more value for that learning resource. So you don't have to generate all the resources. If I give you permission to use my resource, you give me permission for using your resource, that makes life easier for any teacher. So creating learning networks, creating learning communities are possible because of information and communication tools. The fourth aspect or the effective use can be improving productivity. This productivity refers to individual productivity as well as team productivity. Because we can create on our own, productivity increases. So having photographs, if you visit a monument and you take 100 photographs, you put them on Flickr. So now what happens? That becomes a resource. It increases your productivity. If you are working in a group and every group member contributes significantly, the group productivity increases. And this is possible because the tools which are available to you are user friendly, gives control to the users, which was not so earlier. We shall see some of the experiments in higher education where a lot of learning tools, information and communication tools, assessment tools, knowledge generation tools are used. There are many experiments, but first we will see four of them. One is flipped classroom, other is open education resources, third is massive open online courses, and fourth is user generated content. Let us discuss them in details. Flipped classroom. We have seen it is flipped. Flipping the classroom means changing the atmosphere of the classroom, changing the processes of classroom. How do we generally have a classroom process? A teacher goes to class and he or she speaks and students answer the questions asked. Generally, it is teacher-determined classroom situation. All the students are sitting in front of the teacher, but they are considered as individual entity. Teacher asks questions, students answer. If a student wants to ask a question, he or she can ask and teacher answers. Then again, it is one-to-one interaction. Are we using the whole resource? See, I have 40 students in my class, but each individual is sitting in my class. That togetherness, together 40 people can generate lot of things which is missing. So now what we do? So how do we flip the classroom? How do we change the roles? Whatever lecture I want to give, whatever presentation I want to show, whatever photographs I want to share with my students are all kept on class website. You can create a new website or you can use many other tools are available. We have also seen we have learning management system. Use that, create a classroom there. So all these things are already placed on that website or on that class site. And students know in advance that on so and so date, this topic will be taught. So they read that beforehand. Whenever they want to read, even at 2 o'clock at night, if he or she is interested, they can use it. So my lecture, my presentation does not take time in class. They read it and then they come to class. And then there is a group work. What happens when we teach in a class, we give them the assignment. But that assignment is also individual assignment. They may talk to each other, but they don't come together when they are at home. Here what happens, now the 40 students in my class, I have 8 groups of 5 each. Now every group works on some topic or assignment or a project. They work on that and they make a presentation. See, here what happens, what they are expected to do at home, they are doing it here, but together. Whatever I was expected to do in a classroom, I have already done that and students see that at home. So actually, we have flipped the roles, we have flipped the processes. So this classroom is called a flipped classroom. Students are active in the class, they are together, they are working in group. That group synergy is very important for the students to exchange. Because ultimately we have just seen that today's generation has to work in a group when they go in the world of work. And here in flipped classroom, you give that opportunity to students to work in groups, to listen to each other, to contribute significantly, to influence others with your own views. many things, many skills which are needed in real world life, real work life, you are giving them here. This is a new trend. Many universities, many colleges, even many schools are trying to use flipped classroom. The assessment process in flipped classroom also will be different. You cannot always give them the written test. There are many other tools which you can use, and we will see that what new tools can be used. But in flipped classroom, you also can use flipping of your assessment process as well. One more trend in higher education today with respect to information and communication technology use is open educational resources. You can see that for a teacher and for a learner, variety of tools are available to generate resource. Why this resource is called open educational resource? It is open, that means it is freely available to the user. When I prepare a PowerPoint presentation, I use it my own class, but I don't give it to others. Can I give it to others? There are tools, there are sites, there are platforms available on which I can just put this presentation. But I may allow others to see it, but not to use it. If I give this permission to use also, then this becomes open. Anybody can make use of this presentation. Now the next stage is I give you permission to modify my presentation. Of course, you will have to say that this is prepared by Professor Vasudha Kamath. But you make a modification and you write your name on those slides. This is also possible. That saves a lot of your energy and time because you don't have to do right from A. Many things are already done. Those professors, teachers, if they give you permission to use whatever they have prepared, with due respect, due information, due recognition, then it saves a lot of your time in generating the new resource again. So openness refers to giving permission to use the resources created by one person to others. Now what are these resources? Which are these resources available to us on which we can put them? You see a list, a variety of lists, variety of tools are available today. For example, podcast. There are many learning repositories like Merlot. This is a repository of lot of different learning resources. If you want presentations, if you want essays, if you want articles, if you want audio clips, if you want video clips, there are many things available on Merlot. There is another site which is called Kariki, that is Curricular Wiki. It is a wiki, that means coming together and generating knowledge. They invite you to post your own resources and make them available to the users. There are many tools available like podcast, textbooks, videos, images, libraries, open journals, open courseware, learning objects, open source software, and many such things, many platforms and many tools are available to a teacher or a learner, which are called open educational resources. I am sure you are aware about MIT, Massachusetts Institute of Technology, USA. They have taken a bold step of making all their resources available to the world. And now many universities are following their footsteps. You will see here that many universities in variety of many countries, they are generating resources and making them available as open source courses. You will see here that if we use open educational resources, OER, the cost of education will come down to 15%. Not by 15%, by 85%. If presently you are charging 100 rupees, you can charge them only 15 and still high quality higher education can be provided. How does this happen? The most of the cost in higher education is that of creating knowledge, creating learning resources. If we use already created resources which are open, then the cost is reduced and the cost to learners is only 15%. And that is why there is a movement now to form Open Education Resource University. It is called OER University, and Professor Wayne McIntosh, he has taken a lead in this, and SNDT Women's University is one of the 8 pioneering members of this OER University. What is the idea? Universities generally design their own courses. diploma courses, certificate courses, master's degree program, undergraduate programs. Now every program has 4 credit course or 3 credit course. Now this course can be designed, developed by the universities and put it into this university. And other universities are free to use them and charge for their service. So now if 32 more programs are available to me, our university doesn't have to work. Only thing that we can modify it or accept it if in totality or modify it to some extent as per our needs. The cost of designing the curriculum is reduced. Cost of creating learning resources for teaching those courses is also reduced. What we charge student is only for services. That is why now there are universities who are thinking of charging negligible fees to the students, because it should not be a profit-making organization. Our universities, many of the universities are state universities or central universities. They certainly can make use of this OER so that the resources which are generated can be made available to all the students in the country. In this respect, our central government, Ministry of Human Resource Development, has taken a lot of initiative. Under the NMEICT, National Mission on Education through ICTs, lot of e-content is generated and it is put on a platform for the whole country, for the whole country students of any university to use free of charge. This kind of movement should be strengthened further by contribution of each professor, user, expert who wants to work in this area. Another trend which has picked up and which is going at a very fast pace is massive open online course, MOOC, we call it MOOC. If you see the words massive, open, it is open, now we know what is open because it is free. All the resources are made available free. It is online course, it is not in a face-to-face mode. The learner has to study this online. But what does massive mean? Massive means number of students is massive. In our class, we will have 40 students. In a distance learning course, you may have 1,000, 10,000. Here, you will find there are not 1 lakh, there can be 10 lakh students in for one course. Those who have registered, the number is immense, huge, massive. So can one teacher teach to 10 lakh students? This is an experiment. Massive open online courses is an experiment in doing that. How does one teacher teaches? It's not one teacher. They are using open platform, open resources, learning communities, communities of participation. All the students are not considered as individual students. They form their own groups. They create knowledge. They listen to teacher. They use the resources given by the teacher. But they also create their own resources individually as well as in a group. A lot of new tools are coming up which are used by learners who have registered for massive open online courses. You will see here that some of these big names, Udacity, Coursera, edX, many universities are coming up. They have created a platform and they are offering MOOCs. Many philanthropists, industrialists are coming forward to support this financially. Otherwise, it would not be possible to provide this kind of support to the learners free of cost. Massive open online courses are offered in a variety of areas, right from language teaching to programming language in engineering. It is possible. And learners are registering, learning. Now, in all the universities, we have introduced choice-based credit system. In choice-based credit system, we are giving choices to students to not only to select the subject, but also to select the mode of learning. If the student wants to learn in face-to-face mode, he or she can do that. If he or she wants to do it through distance mode, they are free to do it. Only thing that we should arrange for it. And the third alternative could be MOOC, because MOOC are advertised already. They are made available. So the students interested in doing that can register. The universities can allow the students to take MOOC. But because there are massive number of students, it is not possible for any MOOC to evaluate the students. I'm not saying not possible, it is difficult for them, it is a challenge. But if the learner wants to get credits, then he or she will have to pay. Then it doesn't become free. The course is free, but the assessment and evaluation will be charged. So you pay for that assessment, you get yourself assessed, you get those credits and bring those credits to the university. Now this is also possible. On other hand, the universities, university teachers can see what are the content of this course, MOOC, and they can assess the student and give the credits. That is also possible. MOOCs can be one of the alternatives for choice-based credit system. MOOC is massive only for its number of students, but it is not massive for the content. It gives you 3 credits, it gives you 4 credits, it's a course taught across for whatever time limit, 15 weeks or 10 weeks or 3 weeks, whatever. Because it gives credits, if you pay, you will get assessed and you will get credits. Now there is another trend, as opposed to this, the content, that is called NOOC, Nano Open Online Course. This nano does not refer to the number of students, it refers to the content. I do not want to study the whole research methodology course of 4 credits. I only want to know qualitative methodologies. Can I do that? In the present situation, in a face-to-face mode, it is very difficult, it is challenging administratively. So student has to enroll for 4-credit course and study everything. Why can't they register only for qualitative methodologies? It is possible. So say that is only 1 credit. Can I take out 1 credit from my whole 4 credits course and teach? Yes, it is possible. People are trying out this. This is called Nano Open Online Course. It is still in a budding stage. People have to explore it further. We can give 0.5 credit, we can give 1 credit, we can give 2 credits. We need not always think about giving full-fledged 4-credit course. That is the main idea of NOOC. One more trend in use of ICT in higher education is user-generated content. You see here the kind of tools available to a learner or a teacher or content generator is immense. We have given only a small part of it here. What is user-generated content? It is a content generated by the user. That user may not be expert. The user may not be a teacher. That user may be a learner. Of course, he or she can be teacher as well. Those who want to use, they also have the right to generate. That is the basic idea. So as I said earlier, if I prepare my PowerPoint presentation as a learner, it is user-generated content. If I prepare a series of photographs, not prepare, but I take photographs from different angles, from showing certain concept, that becomes user-generated content. Now, you see here one example. If you just take Google, Google provides you variety of tools. For example, Google Earth. Not only geography and history students can make use of Google Earth and create their own films, everybody can do that. And not only on Earth, the title is Earth, but they are also providing you an experience under the sea as well as in the sky. So you can travel on the Earth anywhere, you can travel in the sky, you can also travel in the ocean and take photographs, make a film and use that as a learning resource. Similarly, Google Pack, Google Blogger, Google SketchUp, Google News. You see here Google Maps, Google Sky Map. Many tools are made available by Google. Similarly, there are many other platforms which are making such tools available to user to generate their own content. This becomes very valuable because it is saving time. It is also giving us different perspective, different angles for any concept, any process or any phenomena. The whole teaching learning process becomes very valuable, rich with experience from different users. Some of the tools mentioned here, you can see that there are, for example, blogs. We have seen that. There can be vlogs, there can be mlogs. Moblogs is mobile blogs, wikis, microblogs. All these are available to users to create their own resource and also to share with others. There are two things, one is to create and other is to share. So some of the tools help you to create and some of the tools will help you to post, to share, to communicate with others. You can have your opinions and reviews, and for this you can prepare a video, you can write an article, you can have photographs, you can have a presentation. Many forms can be used and they can be shared.